as I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him.
Today's scripture is from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22-31. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole world. And he marked out their appointed times of history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being,
moved to the house, and the house had been lived in for 5 years, and the lady who had lived in the house was not real particular housekeeper in the house, so bottom line was the place was kind of a mess, and we had a lot of work to do, but it was absolutely overrun with mice. And so the first thing I did was look around for some cats. One of the fellows at the Lathrop Christian Church had a mother cat who had just given birth to kittens. And so we got four little fluff balls, and I had a good time raising those. The first night that I had them, they were all up on their tiptoes, fatting at me, and it was kind of cute to see a little fur ball with tail stuck right straight up, fatting at you. But anyway, we made friends pretty quick. And it wasn't very long until I could say here, and all four of them just kind of running and jumping up on my lap. Well, anyway, two of them survived, and we had a couple of cats around the house there for a while. Well, I was working out in front of the garage one day, and I heard this awful ruckus going on. I didn't know what it was, but it was making a lot of noise, and obviously there was something, some turmoil in the air. Well, we had quite a few robins around the house there also, and one of the young robins had fallen out of its nest and was fluttering around trying to learn to fly, and you know what happens when you got a couple of cats around. Well, the next thing I know, a terrified-looking cat is coming running at me and zooms past me into the garage back underneath something where it could hide. And here comes another robin in right behind me right there, and she wants a pound of flesh. Well, the father robin comes there and lights right in front of me like, what are you going to do now, you know? The hair standing up on his head, and it was really pretty comical because he kind of looked at me and then he had second thoughts. Maybe this wasn't such a good idea after all. But it kind of proves a mother's instinctive love and protection that that mother robin was going to go after that cat no matter what. Mothers just instinctively protect their offspring, and they will give their lives a moment's notice for their offspring, for their children. Back when I was a child, probably about Josh's age, you used to be able to buy these things with a paddle that had a rubber band on it, and then there was a little rubber ball out on the end of it. And that was stapled to the middle of the paddle. Well, the object was to hit that ball and have it bounce back, kind of like playing tennis with yourself, but have the ball bounce back as many times as it would. Well, usually that didn't last when you got home, but anyway, you had a nice little paddle. Well, we had a very substantial paddle that we came across that was painted red. And Grandma Sue took possession of the red paddle and kept it on top of the refrigerator where her boys could not get to it. And there's been many, many times when the red paddle came down that there was a sobering of the attitude in the house. You know, when you've done something wrong and you, you know that minute when it clicks, you know, I went too far. Well, there are a lot of big boys around who are twice as big as Grandma Sue is now that still have a little tremble of fear when the mention of the red paddle is mentioned. So there's been some correction happening. So with me, it was a fly swatter. I lived in a house with a lot of flies, and we always had a fly swatter around. When the fly swatter came down, it clicked. You've gone too far. It wasn't going to be good. Athens, Greece, in Paul's time, was the brains of the universe. They respected themselves overly. They were the great thinkers. They were the ones that came up with the new ideas. They were the forward-thinking people. They were the what we call the about. You're talking about a man raised from the dead. You're babbling. You're bringing on a foreign religion that nobody's ever heard about. If you want to talk about this, bring it to the Areopagus. So Paul says, okay, I'll do that. So he comes up to the Areopagus to talk with these fellows who know everything about everything, and he tells them. He doesn't really challenge them and tell them they're stupid and ignorant, but he says, he kind of compliments them. It kind of brings them in. He's thought this through. He prepared for this. And he said, men of Athens, I see that you are very, very religious. And you have a religion. You really respect your gods. But I also see that you have an idol out here with the name underneath it, the unknown God. So you evidently think there might be something else. And let me tell you that there is. There is one God. There is one God, the creator of this earth, who created everything and gave life and breath to men. He created Adam, and through Adam he created all peoples. He is the giver of life. He is a living God. There is but one. There is but one living God. Some people accepted that. And then Paul goes on to say, this living God will judge each of us someday. And he has appointed a man to do this. And this man's name is Jesus Christ, whom he raised from the dead. Well, there were people who accepted it. There were people who believed, who just accepted it at a moment's notice, and just took it all in and said, okay, wow, that's neat. We want to hear more. Tell us more about this. Tell us more about this. We want to know more. We want to know it all. There were others who were kind of in the middle of the road, and they kind of said, well, maybe that's okay. We've got to go home and think about this. Let us digest this a little bit. And then there were the scoffers, and they said, what are you talking about? Nobody comes back from the dead. Once you're dead, and that's it. So we have a whole wide field of acceptance to rejection. Don't we still see that today? Don't we still see that today? Yesterday was the on the street ministry, and there were a group of people coming around, knocking on doors, saying, hey, can we pray with you? Are you okay? Are you all right? How are you doing? Is there anything we can do for you? When we go out and talk to others, people who are maybe a little bit iffy, we don't go confident and saying, hey, you need to know this. I've got a story to tell to you, and you sit down and listen, and I will tell you. But you want to go with love. You want to go prepared. You want to go knowing exactly what you believe, and be ready for questions. Be ready to answer questions. You also want to be willing to listen, to hear their side of the story. And we need to be prepared to accept the fact that some people are going to accept that completely, totally, only, all right, tell us more. We want to know more. We're hungry. We're looking for something. And then there's going to be people who will say, well, let me think about this. This is big. I need to think about this, and I need to consider this. And then there are going to be the scoffers, the people who say, hey, it sounds like a good idea, but I'm really not interested. Paul saw all of those things, and we will see all of those things when we share our faith. But our God And we can meditate on Him, we can meditate on His words. The 46th chapter of the book of Psalms says, "Be quiet, be still, and know that I am God." Be quiet, be still, and know that I am God. God wants us to seek Him, to come after Him, to look for Him, to be hungry for Him. There's something missing in each one of us life if we don't have the full essence of the living God. We're really proud of ourselves for being multitaskers. And I used to love to try to do 3 or 4 or 5 things at a time and lots of different tasks going constantly. You know, I'll work a little bit of this, work a little bit of that, let that work a little bit, you know, go around. I think that's exactly what Satan wants us to do, to be too busy to look up, to be too busy to look around, to be too busy to look and see what's really important in life. But we see that all the time. We're just busy. And are we quiet? No. We gotta have noise. We gotta have, some people have what they talking about is quiet noise when they sleep. They have to have the ocean roaring or battling brook or something like that. But they have to have noise constantly. Something has to be going on. We have to fill our ears and keep things busy, because what happens if we don't? Well, it's really, really quiet. And all of a sudden, we face ourselves, and we have to look at ourselves, and we have to say, what have you done? What have you done? God would like for us to be quiet and to come to Him respectfully, but totally, wholly and completely, giving ourselves fully to Him and allowing Him to speak to us. 8th chapter of Romans says, we don't know how we should pray. We don't know how to pray. But the Spirit of God intercedes with our spirit. When we try to pray, the Spirit of God looks into our spirit and translates that to God. That's how the Lord wants us to seek Him. Deeply, reverently, quietly, but fully. We are said we will stand in front of God someday, and we will be judged. But we will be judged by Jesus Christ. And if we remember, He told His disciples, all power of heaven and earth has been given to me. I have the keys to death and hell. We will be judged by a big brother who loves us with a love we cannot imagine. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for Your message. Thank You for Paul, who was such a missionary and took Your word out. Lord, help us to be ready to witness of You and of Your love and of the good feelings of confidence that You give to us and the strength of going out and mentioning Your name and giving to others. If it's just love, if it's just loving others, then help us to be about it. Help us to do it fully, as Jesus did, in His name.